we'd pull out a Mark Lowry song. And when I looked up about it, it didn't give me anything other than it said, all the songs that he writes, they're all personal experiences. So this one is Make It Real. I've seen a lot of crazy things done in your name. I know the tricks behind the magic show. I've almost thrown the towel in a time or two and walked away from everything I know. But I can still feel this emptiness inside of me, or calm the troubled waters of my mind. So if you're really out there and you're listening, then prove to me that those who seek will find. If you can just see fit to show me some of who you are, if you can shed some light into this broken sinner's heart, I need to know the truth, and I need something I can feel. I need you to make it real. There must be some good reason why you brought me here, through valleys where the shadows hover close. Down here there's a mask to cover every face, but your sweet face I long to see the most. So if you think there's just the slightest hope for me, in spite of all my questions and my doubts, then let me hear your still small voice speak out my name, and let me know what others talk about. If you can just see fit to show me some of who you are, if you can shed some light into this broken sinner's heart, I need to know the truth, and I need something I can feel. I need you to make it real. I need to know the truth, and I need something I can feel. Oh, I need you to make it real. Make it real.
I don't have a new song. And my fingers are old, so y'all remember that, isn't it?
Oh, if you could see this sweet face right here, it's precious.
Yeah, James, come on up and help us sing. Here's a song called I Can't Even Walk Without You Holding My Hand. Surely be me. I thought thought I could be what I wanted to be. I thought I could build on life's sinking sand. But Lord, I can't even walk without you holding my hand. I can't even walk without you holding my hand. The mountains too high and the valleys too wide. Down on my knees, I've learned to stand. Lord, I can't even walk without you holding my hand. I thought I had done a lot on my own. I thought I could make it all alone. I thought of myself as a mighty big man. Lord, I can't even walk without you holding my hand. I can't even walk without you holding my hand. The mountains too high and the valleys too wide. Down on my knees, I've learned to stand. Lord, I can't even walk without you holding my hand. One day I made Jesus my all and all. From now on, when I'm in trouble, on his name I'll call. But if I don't trust him, then I'm less than a man. Because I can't even walk without you holding my hand. I can't even walk without you holding my hand. The mountains too high and the valleys too wide. Down on my knees, I've learned to stand. Lord, I can't even walk without you holding my hand. Lord, I can't even walk without you holding my hand.
All right, that was great. Good job. We enjoyed that very much. All right, our fellowship hymn is 217, Oh, How I Love Jesus. We're going to sing through it one time, and then we will stand up and wave. Wave to everybody. Let everybody know that you are glad to see them today. Oh, how I love Jesus. Join me in standing. 217, there is a name I love to hear.
There is a name I love to hear. I love to sing its worth. It sounds as music in mine ear, the sweetest name on earth. Oh, how I love Jesus. Oh, how I love Jesus. Oh, how I love Jesus, because he first loved me.
All right, everybody wave. Good to see everybody here today. Hey, Jesus. Him at this time. I'm going to ask the usher to come and lead us in a word of prayer and dedication. And if you'd like to leave an offering or if you have a prayer request, there's always, you can tear this portion out or you can do anything with it and or write any kind of note. We'd like be glad to support and lift you up in any way. So, but the offering plates are at the door. Our offertory hymn is 606, I Gave My Life for Thee. And let us sing the first and the fourth. I gave my life for thee.
I gave my life for thee, my precious blood I shed, that thou might ransom be and quicken from the dead. I gave my life for thee. What hast thou given for me? I gave my life for thee. What hast thou given for me?
And on the fourth.
And I have brought to thee down from my home above salvation full and free, my pardon and my love. I bring rich gifts to thee. What hast thou brought to me? I bring rich gifts to thee. What hast thou brought to me?
All right. Oh, David, yes, if you come and lead us in a word of prayer. Thank you, David.
Let us pray. Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you for this day. We thank you for this opportunity for us to join together in your house and praise your name. We pray, dear Lord, that you be with Brother John as he brings the message today. You be with those that didn't join us today and bring them back safely and healthy. And we pray that you receive these offerings, you use them to further this church's purpose in your kingdom. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
To share one more mission story, and then we'll share the kids' riddles in just a second. And there's still prayer guides if you'd like to look at those from the North American Mission Offering. And I'm not well for the receiving the North American Mission Offering, but from our prayers for our missionaries. But I thought I'd share one story. These are stories of ministries that are going on all around our country. And thought it might be fun to take one little picture here. One going on in California.
In our town right here, it's kind of sad. There's been a lot of shootings, a lot of people getting killed, and it looks nice, but it's a little rough. I grew up in Sanger. It was just, you know, drugs, alcohol, in trouble all the time, in and out of jail, and that's where I surrendered my life over to Christ. I gave up. I said, God, I know you didn't create me to live this kind of life. I just give my life over to you. Do something with me. Ever since then, it's just been, there's no going back. It's all Jesus, man.
Before we started the church, he's like, we're going to plant a church. And I looked at him and I said, you are crazy. Like, we were in such a tight financial position that I'm like, there's no way.
I got connected with Southern Baptist and we were able to get funding coming in. So we planted a church. We're more of a laid-back church, you know. And how you look on the outside doesn't matter. Some of the people that come to our church, if they were to visit your church, you guys might be a little scared of them because they might look a little rough, a little tough. We try to get people that are on the street to come to church. We have that opportunity where we feed people. The food draws people in, and the food is our way of using it to share the gospel message, because that is our number one goal.
Seeing these men, these women, these children, to see the joy in their eyes when they realize and they recognize that they're not alone. It's just building those connections and letting people know that, you know, they're loved.
What Pastor Jacob has offered us is another opportunity, you know, that the world is not going to give us. Because all of us were wicked men at one point in our lives. But this man looked past all that. He just shows us love that the world didn't show us.
Because of the giving of man that we've been receiving, we're not left alone. That's a blessing, and it helps us just to keep going forward. Be the church to the community, to our neighbors that are right across the street, showing love to them, you know. That's just what it's all about.
All right. God's doing a lot of different work all the time. Sometimes we think the world looks hopeless, but it's not. And wherever the gospel is, there is hope and there is joy. And so we get to share in that, and that's a great thing. All right. Y'all ready for your riddles this morning? All right. Here we go. Let's see where I put these. All right. Let's see if my... Oh, here we go. All right. If you ready, the first one, if you drop me, I'm sure to crack, but if you smile at me, I will smile back. What am I? If you drop me, I'll crack.
An egg.
A what?
Egg.
It could be, but this will smile back at you.
A mirror.
A mirror. That's right. All right. That's good. That's very good. That's very good. All right. And that's very good. All right. You may not get this one, but I liked it, so I'll share it anyway. And what does the sky pay when its bills come due? Anybody know? What does the sky, when its bills come due? We all have bills come due. When the sky's bill come due, just trust me. Go with me. What does it pay?
Rain checks?
Yes, rain checks. That's right. I like that. All right. The Ronies got them all today. All right, let me share one passage of Scripture, see if I can find. Where did I put it? Here we go. Listen to what it says. The crowds were coming to Jesus and listened to him. And listen to what it says in Matthew 7:28. It says this, when Jesus finished saying these things, the crowds were what? Amazed at him. He taught as someone with power. When we hear about who Jesus is and his love and his grace, it's what? It's amazing. And it'll be amazing to people that are down and out, like we saw in that picture, and people that are up and out, have everything in the world. Jesus is amazing. And that's what we're here to learn about. All right. At this time, if the youth want to head to Mr. Don, and then if the elementary want to go with Miss Lori, and Miss Jackie's heading out. There we go. And everybody else, grab your Bibles and turn to the book of Mark. And we're continuing our walk toward Easter. And today we're going to look at the Last Supper. So grab your Bibles this morning and turn to the book of Mark, chapter 14. There we go, Mark chapter 14. We're going to look at the Last Supper, or pictures at Passover. We're going to look at two passages in Mark. The first one in Mark 14, verses 22 through 26. And then we're going to look at the passage just before that when we close out in verses 17 through 21. Emily is our law student and graduating this year. And she is also one of our youth teachers. And Don's teaching for her today. And today she is at Disney. She's at Disney World. And she'll be back with us next Sunday. Glad to have her back. And over the years, we have taken the youth on mission trips down to Orlando. And we've done several different things. We have taught Backyard Bible Club in the resort hotels. They've let us go in there and do that. And that's been a fun experience. We taught 1 year a memorable vacation Bible school in an inner city church in Orlando. It was a little overwhelming, but it was exciting. And we've even done some work. 1 year we painted a church. We worked really hard. And every time we've gone and done that, we've allowed the kids to go to Disney or someplace. One time we went to Universal. A couple times we've gone to Universal. But we've gone to Disney many times, and they've had a good time and had a great time together. And at the Magic Kingdom, the oldest park there in Orlando, over the years, there's two attractions that the upper folks in Disney have tried to get rid of. They tried to change out. But every time folks in the regular world got wind of it, they were furious, and they have never replaced them. And they're there today. And those two attractions are, one is the Carousel of Progress, and the other is Swiss Family Robinson's Treehouse. And twice they've tried to get rid of them, but the people don't want them to go. And why? Because they're not roller coasters, they're not high tech, but they give a great picture. In the Carousel of Progress, it gives you the picture as you sit there and go around this big circle, a picture of what the past, the present, and at least what they think the future would be. And you come out there humming a song. It's a great, big, beautiful tomorrow. But it's fun. It gives you a picture of that, that you take with you. And on the Swiss Family Robinson Treehouse, you literally get to go in that movie. You get to climb up that tree and see where they lived, and at least where you think they lived, where it made up they live. But it's like really being there. And you leave with that picture in your head, and makes you want to return. Now, as we come to the Last Supper, Jesus gives at this Passover two pictures, and he wants you to take with you that will never leave you. One, he gives you a picture of what the Savior is about to do to ensure your salvation, what he's willing to do, and we see a picture of that. And then also we see a visual picture of what God is willing to do and how God reaches out to you, for you to respond to his love. So first of all, we get a picture of God's redeeming sacrifice in this Lord's Supper, in this Last Supper. So if you look with Mark chapter 14, let's look at verses 22 through 26. Follow along with me. In Mark 14, it says, "While they were eating, Jesus took bread, he gave thanks, and he broke it. And he gave it to the disciples, saying, 'Take, eat, this is my body.' Then he took the cup and he gave thanks and offered it to them, and they all drank from it. 'This is my blood, the covenant which is poured out for many,' he said to them. 'I tell you the truth, I will not drink it again, the fruit of the vine, until the day when I drink it anew in the kingdom of God.' And it says, when they had sung a hymn, they went out to the Mount of Olives." Now, a number of years ago, a group of us went to a biblical antiquity center, about an hour away. And that center brought things to life. It's really a great place. You pull up and you just see one little building and think, well, this is not going to be much there. You see some old things, some antiquities. And then it keeps getting bigger and bigger. And you eventually go out to the back and there's actually a village, a life-size village you walk through that will give you an idea what it felt like to be in the New Testament times. And at the end of that, or before the tour is done, they gather you in a room and you sit down and they go over what the Passover meal would have been like when Jesus and the disciples received it. And that's the meal that Jesus is sharing with the disciples. And it is during this meal that Jesus brought to life his coming sacrifice for our salvation. And like the prophets of old, he not only spoke God's word, but he brought them to life. Now, what was the Passover meal? Glad you asked. Of course, the Passover meal is a remembrance of when God delivered the people of Israel out of slavery in Egypt. And if you remember, he was preparing them to go, and the last of those plagues with the death of the firstborn, and so they put the lamb's blood on their door, and the death angel passed over, and they prepared to be delivered out of Egypt. And they remembered that. And they remembered that Passover each time was 17 steps. You've heard of a 4 or 5 course meal. This was a 17-step meal. It consisted of 17 steps, and here's what they went through that night. First, there was a cup of kiddush, meaning sanctification or separation. And this act separated this from every other meal that they would ever have together. The head of the family, in this case, Jesus, took the cup, he prayed over it, and then they all drank from it. Second, it began the first of many hand washings that take place in this elaborate meal and ceremony. And then, the third thing they would do is they would take a piece of parsley or lettuce, they would dip it into a bowl of salt water, and then it would be eaten. The parsley stood for the hyssop, which was used to put the blood on the doorpost, which allowed God's death angel to pass over and to spare them. And then the salt water represented two things. One, it represented the tears that they shed in Egypt when they were in slavery, the oppression that they felt. And then it also represented the Red Sea, which Israel would pass through when God divided it and then bring it crashing down upon the Egyptian army that would give them deliverance. And then four, they would break bread. There was a blessing set over the bread, and then there'd be a table, and there'd be 3 round loaves of unleavened bread. And they would take from the middle bread, and they would break from off that, and they would share that. And this had several reminders. One, it was the bread they said of affliction that they ate in Egypt, the hard times that they experienced. And also, it was always broken. Why? Because a slave never had a whole loaf of bread. He only had pieces. He only had leftovers that he could have or experience. Now, at this point, one thing's different. If you're ever around a Jewish family, they will intersect this one little phrase at this time. They will all say together, "This year we keep it here. Next year in the land of Israel. This year as slave, next year as free." And then the fifth step they would take was the relating of the story. The youngest person would get this line. He would get to say this: "What made this day different from all the other days?" And then the head of the house, and of course Jesus this time, he'd be the one, tells the whole story of the history of Israel from the beginning down to the great deliverance out of Egypt, which the Passover commemorated. And it tells continually and brings alive the power and the mercy of God. And then they would turn to Psalms 113 and 114 and they would sing it together. And in fact, young Jewish boys, these would be some of the first things that they would learn by memory, Psalms 113 and 114. And then the second cup was drunk, and it was called the cup of Haggadah, which means the cup of explaining. And then the eighth thing they would do is all those present would now wash their hands in preparation for the meal. And then 9, grace was said. And then a small piece of unleavened bread was distributed. And everyone would take the little pieces of bread. And then the tenth step was they would receive bitter herbs, and they would place them between these 2 pieces of bread. And they would dip it in something called the sop. It was a reminder of slavery when they had to make those bricks and that they were once compelled to make. And then the 11th step was a proper meal. The whole lamb was eaten. Any left would have to be destroyed. And then 12th, their hands were cleaned again. And 13, the remainder of the unleavened bread was taken and eaten. And then 14, there was a prayer of thanksgiving. And in that was a petition for the coming of Elijah to herald the Messiah. And how ironic that Jesus would be praying for the Messiah to come. And then the third cup was drunk, and it was called the cup of thanksgiving. And then they would all sing together Psalms 115 through 118. Then the fourth cup was drunk, and then they would sing Psalms 136, and they would have two prayers and then leave. I like one of the endings of one of the last prayers. It says this: "From everlasting unto everlasting, thou art God, and beside thee we have no other king, redeemer, or savior. God is our only hope, and he is." Now, part of the Passover, Jesus made his own. In step 13, the last of the bread, when he ate the last of the bread, he said this in verse 22. Jesus took the bread, and he gave thanks, and he broke it, and he gave it to the disciples, saying, "Take, eat, this is my body." And then in step 14, when they took the cup for the final time, he said in verse 23, "Then he took the cup, and he gave thanks, and he offered to them, and they all drank from it." And Jesus gave them a picture that they would never forget. He said, look at this bread. This bread is going to be my body, which is broken for you. And in just a day, they would see it literally coming true before their eyes. And he says, just as this cup of red wine is poured out, my blood will soon be poured out and shed for you. On Friday, he would live out this visualization. They would never forget the Last Supper or his sacrifice. Now, what did Jesus mean in verse 24? He talks about this blood of my covenant, which is poured out for many. Well, the cup actually stood for the Old Testament. But Jesus was coming to bring a new covenant. God had entered into a covenant with Israel. Now, this word covenant means something like an arrangement, a bargain, a relationship. It's the acceptance of the old covenant is actually set out in Exodus chapter 24. And from this passage, we see that the covenant was entirely dependent on the people of Israel keeping the law. Two interesting things are repeated twice in this passage. One in Exodus chapter 24, verse 3, and then 7. It says, "When Moses had told all the people the Lord's word and the laws, they responded with one voice." What'd they say? "Everything the Lord has said, we will do." And then they repeat that again in verse 7. "Everything the Lord has said, we'll do what? We will do it." They said, "We will all do it." And the truth was, if the law was broken, the covenant was broken. The relationship between God and the nation was shattered. And who is to be this judge? Not somebody in the Washington, D.C. district or anywhere else. Not someone you can plead for or compromise. The judge is God. And since they did what? They did not keep the law. They did not keep it. And the truth is, neither have we ever kept it. Then they were always in what? They were in default. The relationship was always broken. But Jesus said, "I'm introducing and ratifying a new covenant. A covenant in my blood, a new kind of relationship between God and man, between God and you. And it's not dependent upon the law. It's not dependent on you keeping the law. It is dependent on what? On my blood that will be shed on the cross for you." That's to say, its dependency is upon love, God's love for you and me. The new covenant was a relationship that man and God that was not dependent on the law, but on love. Now, men no longer simply are under the law of God. And the law of God's a burden. Why? Not that it's not righteous or just, because we're unrighteous and unjust, and we don't keep it. And we don't keep it, it becomes a penalty. It becomes something that's a burden that weighs upon us. But because of this new covenant and what Jesus did, we don't have to live under the law. What do? We live within the love of God. At least we can if we receive it. That was a picture that Jesus shows to the disciples, and he shows to you and I today. And as Jesus shared the supper, you know, he was sure of two things in his heart and his mind. One, he was sure that he would die. But that's not all. He was sure of what? He was sure that his kingdom would come. He's talking about, I'm not going to drink this again till what? Till my kingdom comes. And when will that be? When he has risen from the dead and he's overcome death, his kingdom would come. There is a God that longs to conquer sin for you. And he conquered that sin on the cross for you. So in this Last Supper, we see a picture of what our Savior was willing to do for you and me. But we also see a picture of how God reaches out to each and every one of us. And to see that picture, we need to look just a little before this passage in verses 17 through 21 in Mark 14. It says, when evening came, Jesus arrived with the 12. And it says, while they were reclining at the table eating. You know, one difference from this supper than the one before they headed out of Egypt. When they were heading out of Egypt, they were standing. Why? Because they were about to get out of Dodge. They were about to run out of there. They were oppressed. They were ready to leave. God told them from then on when they took the supper to recline. Why? Because when you recline, you're safe. When you recline, you have a home of your own. And God was going to give them a home of their own. It was a promise of God fulfilling his promise to them. And Jesus said, he said, I tell you the truth, one of you will betray me, one who is eating with me. They were saddened. And one by one they said to him, surely not I. And I suppose even Judas said that. It is one of the 12, he replied, one who dips bread into the bowl with me. The Son of Man will go just as it is written about him. But woe to the man who betrays the Son of Man. It would be better for him if he had not been born. Now, Jesus could see into the heart of Judas, couldn't he? He could. It is a curious thing that the other disciples couldn't see it, but Jesus did. And you know, we can hide things from all kinds of people, but we can't hide from who we are from God. There's an old song that goes something like this. Our thoughts lie open to thy sight and naked to thy glance. Our sweet sins are in the light of thy pure countenance. God sees everything. He knows who we are. And in this passage, Jesus reaches out to Judas in two ways. He reaches out to us in the same way. One, he makes love's last appeal. He tells him, I know what you're going to do. Will you just stop it? You can right now. You know, that's what God says to us. In John 3:16 and 17, he says, for God so loved the world that he sent his one and only Son, that whoever believes in him shall not perish but have eternal life. For God did not send his Son into the world to condemn the world but to save the world through him. In love, he reaches out to you. And won't you receive that before it's too late? That's what he said to Judas, and that's what he says to each and every one of our hearts. And secondly, he offered Judas one last warning. He tells him of the consequences. If you do what you're about to do, you're going to wish you had never been born. In John 3:18, Jesus completes the thought as he's talking to Nicodemus, and he says, whoever believes in me is not condemned, but whoever does not believe stands what? Condemned already. That's what the truth is. Jesus warns us. God gives us all one last warning. Now, how God treats us. How does God treat us? Well, he compels us, but he does not force us. He always leaves us a choice. If Jesus had wanted, Jesus would have never left that room. And I heard one of the writers I was reading on this week says if Jesus just told the disciples what Judas was going to do, he would have never left that room alive. They would have stopped him. They would have given their lives. But God has given us all wills, and he's given us a free will that we can choose. And his love calls out to us, and his truth warns us, but he gives us the choice. And as someone said, we all have the awful responsibility. We can spurn his appeal. We can disregard his warning. And if we do, then there's only one person to blame, and that's not him, it is ourselves. In the Greek legend, Homer tells of Ulysses and Orpheus. and two famous travelers who pass by the siren song. Those sirens that sing on the rocks, and as the sailors would come by, they'd be so entranced by their song, they'd crash into the rocks and die. Well, Ulysses was real smart, and he knew that was coming, so he put wax or something in all his sailors' ears, but he wanted to hear what the song was like, and he thought he'd be overwhelmed by it, so he went to the mast and had himself lashed to it, tied up with ropes, because he knew he couldn't overcome it, and that was his formula for success. There was another fellow, Orpheus, who was said to be the sweetest musician of all. His method was a little bit different. When he played and sang, when they came near the sirens, he simply played a song that was sweeter and stronger and truer than that of the sirens. So the sailors did not want to listen to the sirens. They wanted to listen to him, and they sailed on through to safety. That is God's way. God does not stop us. He does not hinder us from doing what would harm us. He simply sends his love in such a compelling way that when we see it, nothing else matters. And it opens up our hearts, and we turn away from everything else, and we follow him. But we still have a choice to make. We have a choice to make to follow and to receive him. And the question is, what will you do with that? What will you do with the pictures that Jesus has given of sacrifice? What will you do with the truth that Jesus loves you and he calls to you out one last time and he warns you one last time? Will you respond to that? Will you receive him even as one of the thieves on the cross received him? Or will you reject him and will you go on about your life? Jesus came so that you could be redeemed. The truth is we all stand condemned. But we need a Savior, and praise God, God was willing to send the Messiah, our Savior Jesus, willing to die, even though he knew what was coming. Why? Because he loves you, and he loves me. If you've not received him in that way, you need to. And if somehow you've strayed away from following the one who loves you most and the one who longs to give you the most, maybe today's the day to turn back to him. Let's pray. Dear Lord, as we look at the Last Supper, as we remember your sacrifice and your love, which you not only displayed what would happen, but you really went through for us. Lord, if there's anyone here who does not know you as Savior and Lord, speak to their hearts. Give them the courage to receive you today. And for those of us who already know you, if we've begun to take this for granted, let us never do that, Lord. Let us not only praise you and rejoice in what you've done for us, but Lord, let us follow you and let us share the good news, especially as we see Easter approaching. Lord, in this time of invitation, speak to our hearts. Help us to turn to you in our needs, turn to you for encouragement, turn to you for salvation, turn to you to follow. We love you, Lord. We thank you for loving us. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. If you take it this time, we'll have a brief invitation. God speaking to your heart, you need someone to pray for you, be glad to do that. You need to receive the Lord, or you want to come and join our fellowship, or just take a new step of faith. Today is your day. Let us turn in our hymnals and Redeemed How I Love to Proclaim. We're going to sing 544, if you will turn to that. 544. Redeemed How I Love to Proclaim It. Join us in standing. Redeemed, how I love to proclaim it. Thank you. as we approach to Easter and to Good Friday, let us remember his love for each and every one of us. He longs to stand beside us. I invite you back tonight. We have our Bible study at 5 o'clock. Love to have you come. Biblical justice and taken right out of the headlines from God's Word. Our closing hymn is Holy Ground. We're going to sing 224. 224.